674, wait, my soul to God draw near.
Thank you.
gathered with us on Wednesday evening to study God's Word. Our services next Sunday will be at 11 in the morning and 6:30 in the evening, when the preacher, God willing, will be our pastor. At the close of this morning's service, Dr. Masters and Pastor Ibrahim will be available in their vestries for any who would like to speak with them. And now the stewards will take up our offering for the Lord's Word. Thank you. yet face peculiar difficulties in the days ahead, perhaps even persecution in some form. O Lord, strengthen us all, that we may stand for thee. Grant us thy blessing in everything that we undertake, and be present with us day by day in our personal devotions, that we may know thy nearness, that we may be strengthened and lifted up. O Lord, we thank thee. verse 25, these things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. Our subject this morning is lessons in love. Now, I had intended to bring a text which would be particularly suited to the new year, the first Sunday of the year. But however, looking at this passage, it's apparent that even to continue with our series of studies brings us to a passage which is outstandingly applicable to this new year, to this first Sunday. So I turn to these closing verses of the Gospel of John, chapter 14. I'd like to actually take you back to verse 23, and there's an important reason for this. Jesus answered and said unto him, to Judas, not Iscariot, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. He that loveth me not, keepeth not my sayings, and the word which ye hear is not mine, but the Father's which sent me. Now, those two verses really stand over everything that follows. You could say they dominate everything that follows to the end of the chapter. Particularly these words in verse 23, if a man love me, he will keep my words. And the whole passage is about love to Christ. And that's why I've called it Lessons in Love. And there are a number here of expressions of love implicit in these verses. Expressions of love for Christ. And these are vital for us, and almost a keynote, a motto passage for a new year and for a time of dedication. If a man love me, he will keep my words. Now, bearing that in mind, we go down to verse 26, and the Lord immediately points out that his words will continue to come, but not from his own lips, because his presence with them, his time with them, has come to an end. And now he is going to suffer, to die, to rise again from the dead, to ascend into heaven, and to resume his position at the right hand of God the Father, as the second glorious reigning person of the Trinity, equal with the Father, equal with the Spirit. He will no longer be on earth to instruct them personally, but more is going to come from him through the Holy Spirit. Verse 26, but the Comforter, or the Advocate, or the Helper, it might be translated, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, in the place of Christ. He shall teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. So our first point is this. Love, this is lesson
darkness, and far from God, and unconverted. And that day comes when suddenly our eyes are opened, and we realize that spiritual things are true, and we realize that the gospel is true, and we understand it in a way that we never grasped it before. The Holy Spirit illuminates dead souls and begins the work of grace in their lives. And even after conversion, he goes on reminding us, opening our minds as we read the scripture, helping us to understand. That's one sense. He shall teach you all things. He will not teach anything once the scripture is complete. He will not teach anything which is not in the scriptures. He will often remind us of the scripture. Things will come to our attention, but he will not reveal anything new. No authoritative truth comes to any Christian outside the scripture. Now, this brings us to the next all things. And bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. By the Holy Spirit, the apostles will be inspired, the gospels will be written, epistles will be written, many things in the New Testament will be written by people who are not apostles, but everything must be attested, authenticated, verified by the apostles, because the Holy Spirit is especially given to them for the revelation of the New Testament. And some are enabled to remember so vividly and so clearly, absolutely accurately, without any fault or mistake, everything that Christ did and said, which is to be recorded in the Word of God. Everything, all things, nothing was left out. So the Bible, with the passing of the apostles, was complete. All things were revealed by the Spirit to them. The Old Testament was already complete. Now the New Testament is going to be completed by the inspiration and the direction of the Holy Spirit of God. So the Jude, when he writes his epistle, can look back and can already say, faith once delivered unto the saints. Complete. Nothing more to be added. The wisdom of God. That the entire scripture was given within the time of the apostles. Complete. Inerrant. Perfect. Never through time would we be confused by new revelations, by claims of men, by additional ideas. God would complete it in the time of the apostles, and it would stand as a sure guide, as a yardstick in all disputes, as the sole source of authority. That's all here. But I want to draw out particularly that to learn is an aspect of love. Remember, if a man loved me, he will keep my words. Well, here are some of those words. The comfort of the Holy Spirit shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. Love for Christ loves to learn. Do I see in the congregation? I don't. I'm just speaking in illustrative terms. But do I see in the congregation somebody asleep? Not because they're tired, but because they're bored. Not because they're tired, word, if we make it dull, if we make it uninteresting to the people of God, it's a terrible thing. It's like somebody cooking a meal who isn't the slightest bit interested in how it turns out and how palatable it'll be and how interesting it'll be. Dear friends, it is a responsibility. But I pass from that to a second heading. And this will be love, trusts. And we go to verse 27. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Remember, this is all under the heading, if a man love me, he will keep my words. Verse 27 is quite remarkable. It begins with a blessing, and it proceeds to a responsibility or a duty. And the blessing is given first. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. And then the duty, let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. So the blessing incurs a tremendous responsibility that we trust him and we don't let our heart be troubled. But it's the language of legacy. Peace I leave with you. The Lord didn't leave the disciples any money. He didn't leave them any property. He didn't leave them anything of that kind. He left them something vastly greater. His peace. And he uses the language of a legacy. Peace I leave with you. This word peace comes up again in chapter 20. The resurrected Lord, I won't turn to it, peace be unto you. Then he says it again, peace be unto you. Then a third time, peace be unto you. This is the legacy of Christ. What do we have? Reconciliation with God through the cross of Calvary. He came, he would suffer and die for his disciples and for all his people in order that they could be reconciled with God. That's peace, reconciliation with God. Think of that, friends. What do you possess? Lands, estates, wealth. What do you possess? An education that can earn you a living, all sorts of things, something that towers above them. I have reconciliation with my God. I may pray to him, call upon him, receive his blessing from on high, walk with him, live with him forever. And I could never merit this. It is because Christ died for my sins and drew me to himself. I am reconciled with God. In all the troubles of life, as they come, there's something which soars above them all. I have reconciliation with God. I know him and walk with him, and he knows everything. That's the first thing. The second thing is, you have certain outcomes in life. My peace I give to you. What is the peace of Christ? Oh, I have certain outcomes. I know how everything is going to turn out. hostility. Fear would erode away their peace. Same with us. Anxieties. Things go wrong in life. Troubles come. Griefs and disappointments. And if we allow them to overwhelm us, you can't chase them away. You've got to live through them, react to them, respond to them, pray for help, do your best. You can't just airbrush them out of life. But on the other hand, they mustn't overwhelm us and take our peace. So the command comes with the blessing, let not your heart be troubled. Don't let it happen. Remember the promises. Remember your blessedness. Remember to go to prayer. Neither let it be afraid. If Satan comes and tempts you and tells you you can't possibly be saved and robs you of your assurance and casts you into doubt, don't let it happen. Pray to God for help. Comfort yourself with the promises of God. Remember your testimony. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. So love trusts. Verse 23, if a man love me, he will keep my words. Among the words are these, let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Love will trust. Love will remember these things. And trust, it may be this very day, on leaving this service, something will happen, someone will say something, and some Christian person will be thrown. And all the blessing of worship will have gone in an instant. And there'll be grumbling, or blame, or recrimination, or unhappiness. We've forgotten already. Love for Christ trusts him. Don't let it happen. Trust him. Yes, pray for strength to deal with things in a right manner, but don't be thrown to the ground. Love trusts. We want proving love this year. And then we come to a third expression of love, and it's here in verse 28. You have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come again unto you. If ye loved me, ye would rejoice, because I said I go unto the Father, for my Father is greater than I. Now, the problem here in this verse is that the disciples loved him, but not entirely. We speak of, we have a phrase, this will help, person and work of Christ. You see, the Christian loves not only his person, but his work, his cause. Now, the disciples had only got as far as loving his person. They loved him, and they didn't want him to go. And so he says to them, if you really love me, if you wholly love me, you would see I'm going to do my work. I'm suffering and dying for sinners to save millions and millions of people. I will succeed and rise from the dead and go to my Father. If you love my work as well as me, you would rejoice in that. You would say he is going to Calvary to make an atonement for all the redeemed and then to ascend back into his glory with the Father in eternity. You wouldn't be sad. If ye love me, you would rejoice. dying for sinners. She didn't know about the need to be converted, but she worshipped every week. And she went to church where these things were not preached. But she said to me, I love Christ. And I believe her. She wasn't saved, but she loved Christ. She loved an ideal. She kind of loved his person. He was a wonderful man. He did wonderful things. He preached wonderfully. She didn't love his work, his cause. She didn't understand that. He came to be a savior, to suffer and to die, to redeem the people of God. Even Christians sometimes can fall into only half loving him. You love Christ, but your love is running cold, so you don't identify with his cause. What did he die for? To save souls. Not just yours, but the souls of others. You're not interested in soul winning. You don't come to the gospel service and support it in prayer and seek to bring others. You say, well, I know the gospel, so I don't need to come. You love him, but you only half love him because you've stopped loving his cause, his mission, his work. So you don't have any part in it. You don't witness. You don't teach Sunday school. You don't help visit the community. You don't do anything. Love serves him, identifies with his cause. And that's what he tells the disciples here. Verse 28. Ye have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come again unto you. He's going to come, his second coming here, by the Spirit. And they're going to be his representatives, but they haven't taken that in yet. If ye love me, ye would rejoice. I'm going to suffer, die, accomplish salvation, return to my Father, and leave the church on earth under the Holy Spirit. You'd rejoice. But they didn't identify yet with his work, or understand it, or see their participation in it. Love for Christ identifies. It sees, it serves. So that's a lesson for us in this coming year. And then I go quickly to a fourth heading, and it is this, down in verse 30. Love gives. Hereafter I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me. Yes, there's even a lesson on love implicit here, in the example of Christ. I will not talk much with you. He's only a little more to say. Chapter 15, chapter 16, and the great high priestly prayer in chapter 17, and then his instruction to his disciples is finished. I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world coming. What does that refer to? Well, the arrest party was already being convened, and he knew it. The disciples didn't, but he was God. He knew what was going on. Judas was already instructing them how he would point out Christ to them. The plot was being laid. He would betray him with a kiss. There was being assembled a great band of soldiers, of temple police, Levite police, and many of the Sanhedrin council also, and they were gathering with lanterns and clubs and sticks and other weapons, swords, so the scriptures elsewhere tell us, and they were setting out to go to the spot where Judas knew Christ would go. And so he says, shortly before he ends his prince of this world cometh. Satan is behind Judas. Satan has entered into him, and he appears to have entered also into the chief priests, and they've convened the soldiers and the temple police. They're about to set out. Well, if they're just setting out, why doesn't the Lord go somewhere else that's coming at night? Why is it necessary for him to go to the place where Judas thinks he will go? Why does he not lead the disciples somewhere else? And that will completely thwart the arrest party. He knows. He can see it forming. He knows what will happen. Because he's going voluntarily now. Because it is the will of the Father and the Spirit and the Son. The three persons of the Godhead have determined this in eternity. That Calvary will take place. That Christ will be roughly arrested. Bound. Tried. Executed. They've never been able to take him before now. Now he can see them assembling, and yet he isn't going to change his plan one bit. He will voluntarily go. Hereafter I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh already, you might say, and hath nothing in me. Have you puzzled over those words? Hath nothing in me. Hath. Literally, the Greek is, he possesses nothing in me. Does that seem a curious thing for Christ to say? No, he means it. The prince of this world, the prince of the power of the air, Satan, possesses not the smallest part of me. He has no foothold in my life. He has no handhold on my life. There is nothing in my life, Christ might say, that Satan has a claim on. I have never given anything to him, or given way to him, or responded to any temptation, large or small. I've yielded nothing. He possesses not the tiniest part of me. And included in this is the sense he possesses not the tiniest bit of power over me. I can avoid this arrest party easily, but it is obedience to my Father. I am going ahead. I am proceeding. So he sets an example to us of love here. He loves the Father while he was with the Father when the decision was made. It was his decision equally with the Father. And now he's on earth subordinating himself as our representative. He is going to obey the Father. The prince of this world cometh. Has no influence over me, no power over me, no rights to any part of me. He was perfect. He was the faultless Son of the living God. He had to be perfect in order to suffer and die for our sins. No human being could ever say that. No mere man who was not God also, like Christ. No human being could say that. Satan has no part in me. All of us have sold out in some shape or form, some part of us. So here is surrender, voluntary surrender to God the Father, of God the Son. The prince of this world cometh, and he's going to give himself into his hands to go to Calvary. And finally, as we go to verse 31, allied to that point Even so, I do. Arise, let us go hence. But let us prepare to go, he says. He doesn't go yet. Chapters 15, 16, and 17 are still to be said. But they've risen from the table here, and all the rest of the instruction, they're standing round at the door for the last three chapters. Well, that's possibly how it was. But it's verse 31. But that the world may know that I love the Father. Dear friends, I don't want to complicate matters, but just think of these words. That the world may know. Who's the world? Well, throughout the chapter, the world has always been unbelievers. Whenever Christ refers to the unbelieving chief priests, scribes, and the Pharisees, the leaders of the Jews, the rebellious, he calls them the world. And that's what he means here. This is so interesting. That the world, that the unbelievers, the chief priests, the unbelieving scribes and Pharisees, the persecutors, but that they may know that I love the Father, I'm going to Calvary. Now we know the first reason why Christ went to Calvary was to die for our sins. The second reason he went to Calvary was to carry out the supreme act of obedience to the Father's will. Because it's by his obedience that we earn access to heaven. But there's another reason why he went to Calvary. It's a lesser reason, but it's a very important one. And he tells us here, I also went to Calvary so that those persecutors may know that I love the Father. This is how it works. When they arrested him, they didn't admit it. They didn't say it outwardly, but they knew in their hearts, we have only succeeded in this because he let us. He has voluntarily given himself into our hands. On every other occasion, it proved impossible. And even when he spoke to us on this final arrest, we all fell to the ground. We were thrown down. We'll read about that later. He's unarrested.